Did you know that I got a complaint? Not for myself, but for my other co-ESL teachers. My students said...
But I didn't know what mistake I made unless you told me.
Oh, you're welcome. Of course, actually, I'm your teacher.
That's the way I want. That's the way I want to have this class. But many teacher didn't follow the way I given that to them.
What do you mean to say? Your teachers didn't teach you the way you want to be taught?
Yeah, like this, I made some mistake about grammar. Yeah, you can correct me directly like this. But my teacher always ignore this, just rush and very rush to finish this class. But actually, I'm not very care about. We have to finish this lesson just like this.
I understand. Directly. Well, I'm sorry to hear that you had bad experiences with other teacher, but I'm happy that you are open to feedback, that you want to be corrected for your mistakes, because that is how you will really improve.
Her other teachers lacked knowledge extension, that she didn't learn much from her other teachers, that sometimes the teacher's focus is just to go through the entire lesson book, and that's it. But then again, come to think of it, teachers, there are tons of information online about learning English. And the reason why adult students want to have classes with you is not to hear about the same things that they can watch online through videos. They want to read or they want to receive actual feedback, advice, corrections from their teacher. So, teachers, when you are running classes for adults, don't just focus on going through the book and finishing all its contents. That's not the goal. The goal is to make sure that when your student gets out of that class, they'd be able to have a takeaway. They'd be able to learn something from you, the teacher, because they're speaking to a human being, not to a machine, not to a recorded video. Therefore, feedback is gold whenever we are teaching adult students. So, for this video, I'll be sharing with you 6 tips on how you could better run classes with adult students so that every single time they have classes with you, it would really be something that helps them communicate better, helps them with their job, helps them to be a better parent, be a better teacher, or simply helps them to be a better English communicator. If you're interested, please continue watching. Tip number 1, you must study English. Let's not stick to the ABCs, to animals, to shapes and colors. Let's expand our knowledge in English. Because if you are really familiar with the language in terms of pronunciation, grammar, fluency, vocabulary, then you, the teacher, will have more things to share with your students. You can give them rather better feedback. You can have more knowledge extensions because you, your beautiful mind, is filled with so much information about English. So what I typically do is on my free time, you know, when I have nothing to do, I'd usually just browse English videos, learning English videos. I'll go to Rachel's English, my favorite, and I'll try to review the common grammar rules, pronunciation rules. I'll try to expand my vocabulary because that is your job as the teacher. Tip number 2, know the most common errors of your students. You know, Koreans have different common errors from Japanese students, from Chinese students. And here in AkadSoc, our students are Chinese students, and I actually made a video on the common errors of our Chinese students. These are things that you must know as the teacher so that you're going to be vigilant. You're going to be alert if these errors are actually happening inside your classroom, and you'd be able to clearly explain to them why it's an error and why people like them, people with their nationality, have the same issue or concern about that certain language aspect. So let's say for Chinese students, most of the time they interchange the gender pronouns he or she, because in Chinese they don't have pronouns. Many instances, Chinese students would have difficulties with verb tenses, because again, in their language, verb tenses are totally not a part of it. So by knowing the most common errors of our students, depending on their nationality, we'd be more alert if these errors are actually happening inside our classroom, and we'd be able to correct it in a timely manner. Tip number 3, don't ask two common getting to know you questions, especially if this is already a regular student. Truly have that intention to get to know your students. And if you think that you've already asked that question before, you have to remember the answer to it. I have this student of mine before, and she said, you know, I had to change my book from free talk to this course because I noticed that my teachers kept asking me the same questions over and over again. They kept on asking me about my job. They kept on asking me about my hobbies. And it got to a point when it became exhausting to answer the question or the same questions over and over again. You see, teachers, your students are adults and they remember conversations with you. That's why it's important that you do not stick to the generic getting to know you questions and try asking more genuine questions like, how is your day? Or notice something nice with your students. Oh, you're wearing makeup today. Are you going to any special occasion or is there something special at work today? You know, things like those. Whenever you ask questions like those, they would really feel that you are a friend and you truly care for them. Tip number four, give corrections in a timely manner. You have to give your corrections right away. But of course, never, never, ever, 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 ever interrupt your student, okay? Let them finish first. Then as soon as they've committed the error, they've finished talking, you can provide feedback. Try to give positive feedback first before giving the negative feedback. You could say, oh, I noticed that you were able to read most of the words correctly, but I also noticed that you mispronounced the word educated. Instead of saying the word educated, you said educate. Things like those, teachers, you have to give your feedback right away. Don't wait for the class to be over before you give your feedback. You know why? Because they would have already forgotten when and where they committed that error. By giving timely feedback, they'd be able to know where they committed and when they committed the error, and they are most likely to remember to make sure that next time they say it correctly.
Okay, let's go ahead.
Okay, well, one of the things you said earlier, you said you work for an engineer company. Well, all you have to do is simply add the prefix ing to make it grammatically correct. So we don't really say I work for an engineer company. Instead, we call it an engineering company so that the word engineer will now be an adjective. It's something that describes the noun company. Okay? Because the word engineer is already a noun. That's why we can't use it. Okay?
Yeah. Thank
all right.
You.
You're welcome. Now,
in relation to my previous tip, tip number five, give positive and negative feedback. Of course, your students will feel bad if you just give negative feedback over and over again. If you just give corrections and corrections and corrections to the point that they're going to feel that, am I still improving? Am I still doing anything right in this class? You don't want them to feel that way. So what I usually do is I often do the sandwich approach where I sandwich the negative feedback in between two positive feedback. So just like what I've mentioned, I'll say something nice first, like they were able to read everything well or majority of the words correctly. Then I'm going to give my correction or my negative feedback. Then afterwards, I'm going to say comforting words or a positive feedback again, just to make sure that, you know, me giving that feedback wouldn't sound too negative or too heavy for the student.
But I'd like to give another feedback. You know, Chloe, I noticed that you have very good listening skills and we could have good conversations because you know how to respond properly. Now, one of the things that we can work on based on the things that you've said would be, let's say, your choice of words in terms of grammar. Now, earlier, this is what you said. Yes. Which is usually used for objects, like books or maybe places. But whenever we're pertaining to a person, we always have to use who.
Yeah.
It's okay. There are so many rules in English. So many rules, right?
Tip number six, use your classroom tools. You can use the blackboard or the chat box every time you're giving feedback. What I usually do is I write my feedback on the board, then later on, I'm also going to paste it on the chat box. And why do I do both? I use the blackboard so that my student would have like a visual aid every time I give corrections. They'd be able to remember it most likely because they see a visual representation of their error and they're also able to hear my feedback. I also put it on the chat box so that after class, they'd be able to download all my feedback, all my notes about the class, and they'd be able to go through it on their free time. And tip number seven, give useful advice and suggestion to your students. Once again, don't give them information that, you know, they could already watch or read about online. There's so much information online. So give them feedback and suggestions or recommendations solely based on their areas for improvement and how they performed in class. Let's say if I have a student who's stuttering or who keeps on mispronouncing words, then I could give feedback pertaining to enunciating, trying to exaggerate right pronunciation and maybe practicing in front of a mirror. Or let's say I have a student who's struggling with grammar. Maybe I could give a link or a website on how to improve grammar. Or I can also recommend my student to watch TV shows with English subtitles so that they'd be more familiar with English sentence structures.
With this lesson, well, we were able to finish the book. I can say that indeed, this is a good course for you. Your in terms of your listening and your vocabulary, I think they're good. What we need to focus on for your areas for improvement would be more of your pronunciation as well as your grammar. So I'm going to put it on the board real quick here. So for the pronunciation, let's focus on the last sound, okay? Always make sure that when you read words, you also get to enunciate the last sound. Now, could you try to say this for me, Chloe?
Co-workers.
Yes, there you go. Because if you omit the last sound, it's going to be co-worker, not co-workers. Now, remember, let's also try to learn more about positive connotation, words with positive connotation and words with negative connotation. Just like, let's say, the word demand. I want to demand you, Chloe, to book my classes. The word demand is negative, right? Instead of demand, yes. what could I use? What could I say instead?
What did I say instead?
I could say ask. Or request. These are positive words. Oh, Chloe, I'd like to request you to book my classes, not demand, because these are negative words. Okay?
So yeah.
I'll be adding notes for you, Chloe, so that you could review this after my class. But again, well, unfortunately, we no longer have time, but I do hope to get to be your teacher again next time. Okay?
Oops. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
As you can see, teachers, the feedback that we give our students who are kids are totally different from the feedback we give adults. Our approach for children is totally different from that of an adult. And it's important for us, ESL teachers, to know what approach we're going to be taking whenever we're teaching these kinds of people. Because we don't want to get a complaint or a penalty just because we were not able to do our jobs well. And teaching adults is something that takes practice. It also takes a lot of time and effort on the teacher's part because you have to read, study to improve your craft. So teachers, I hope you learned something from this video. You know, my goal is to really help you be better teachers, not only for children, but also for adults, because I started teaching adults at the age of 23, and it was a face-to-face class. I was the teacher, and I had students who were about like 50 students in a class, and most of them were older than me. But then again, through those years, I was able to truly understand how to be an effective teacher to adult students. So I hope this video has been helpful to you. If you like this content, don't forget to give it a thumbs up. If you haven't subscribed to my channel, please do subscribe to Teacher Karen. Comment below if you have any questions or negative feedback about this video, any video requests, and of course hit that bell icon to get notified for new video uploads. Thank you very much for watching and your continued support, and be a blessing to the people around you. Goodbye, teachers. Have a great day.